And I would next like to invite on the stage Ethel Barona Paul, who is a critic and a writer and a curator, or as she likes to call herself, a professional amateur. And she has also been contributing with Domus and Habitare and Volume, but she's also editing or working at the editing process of Quaderns. She was kind enough to bring some of the publications she has been working on. So this is Quaderns, the magazine, and these are two books that she has been working on at this publishing house that she has co-founded, DPR in Barcelona, which is a research practice that is interesting in publishing curatorship and criticism, and also interested in architecture as at the intersection of economy, technology, society and politics. But I think I should let her tell you more about herself. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the invitation, by the way. Well, thank you very much to all of you for the patience of waiting for me too late. When you invite me to talk about the present, I remind about this quote by Tacit Adin, stating that the future will be obsolete. So I want to tell you a story about the present to reflect why the future will be obsolete. And this story will be divided in three acts, so we can make something funny here, and you will not get asleep there. So the act one is to understand the present as seen by all the others, by mass media, politicians, and all the people who tell us what is the present for them. It's very interesting to think that the present we are living now is not something only for the present. This present was in 1972 in the US with the oil crisis, in Canada, in all North America. So it's very interesting when we try to look back a little bit to understand that the present and the past and the future somehow are almost the same. And suddenly it takes out a lot of pressure of our present.
From France to the Philippines, from Jamaica to Japan, from Malaysia to Mexico, from Sri Lanka to Singapore, privatization is on the move.
Something new had been born. Its name was popular capitalism.
Popular capitalism is nothing less than a crusade to enfranchise the many in the economic life of the nation. We conservatives are returning power to the people. That is the way to one nation, one people.
It's difficult to decide if this speech was from the 80s or from yesterday. So I think it's very good to do this brief travel in time. And now this is the most recent present we have been living worldwide, that is from 2008 until now, with the economical crisis, the political crisis that somehow was mentioned in the previous lectures. This is an example of our situation in Spain that Tamar explained it super well, so I will not spend time on that, how the mortgage system works, how people is being evicted, but at the same time, how banks are taking advantage of that. You can see how from the people who have been evicted, they are selling in a very low prices all these houses just to, for the banks to take advantage of these evictions. So it's easy to understand how the system is so perverse. And this is the kind of images that we see in newspapers, in mass media, every day. Another kind of present we can witness very often is, for example, this kind of queues. This was 2 months ago when the iPhone 6 was presented and was launched. People was doing queues in the Fifth Avenue in New York 2 weeks before the launch of the iPhone. In other countries in the world, the same kind of queues. But it's very interesting that we can see the mass media full of these kind of images, but they never publish these ones, when the workers in other countries need to make another kind of queues to produce the iPhone that you are buying in the Fifth Avenue in New York. Or these images. Since 2010 and 11, with all the Occupy movements and the indignados in Spain, and the big presence of the Anonymous Collective, we have get used to see this mask as a symbol of our struggles and our convictions and the way we want to take back the city and our rights, but nobody shows you these images. So even our protests are part of the same economical perverse system. And this is part of the present we are living as well. This is a film, very short, I think it's 2 minutes, that I want to show you, but because I think summarize this first act of the present in a very good way.
I come home in the evenings and I turn on the television to see what's happening, and then as soon as I wake up in the morning, I've turned it back on just to see if anything's changed since I went to bed.
You sure you wanna be with me? I've nothing to give, but lawyers say this love is best. Leave us in emotional pace. Take a walk, taste a rest. No, take a rest. I seen you digging a hole in your neighborhood. You're crazy, but you're lazy. The need to live and the need to. Your troubles must be seen to. See through money like it's paper. With faces I remember. I drink on a daily basis. The whiz seldom cools my temper. It never cools my temper. Walking through the suburbs, they're not exactly lovers. You're a couple, especially when your body's double duplicating on your way for the next Kuwait. Karma, coma, Jamaican and Roma, karma, coma.
With this message. I was walking in London, I think 1 year ago or two, no, 2 years ago, and I found this this sign nearby the Robin Hood Gardens, just before the demolition process started, and I think it was perfect representation of the current moment we are living. So what happened there? That all this present and all this context we are living just created a fast reaction from the architectural field, from the design field, from almost every field that, and especially in the young people, that it's very disappointed with that previous present and try to react to that. So some of the messages we are trying to digest and to understand is that if we don't have money, okay, let's do something. But what does it mean to do something new? People started becoming super techno-optimism, as Tamar was saying before as well, using Google Glasses, 3D printed, experimenting with new currencies and bitcoins. That the big problem is that when you react so fast, it's a good field to experiment, but at the same time, you are not considering all the process and all the implications of the new things we are creating. So sometimes we create good projects, but sometimes we create failures and bad projects as well. Or projects that doesn't have any real sense, at least for now, they are not solving any real problem for society, as using drones for delivering books by Amazon. I prefer to bring the books with me and create a relationship with the person. Or this new app that provides drones on demand for whatever you want to do. It, let's say, send a book like the Amazon one, or to spy to your neighborhood. Or this proposal by Norman Foster to 3D print a shelter in the moon. So this is very, okay, as a scientific experimental can be really good, but we know the housing crisis we have here, so why to go to the moon to do that instead of solving our projects here? So mostly all of these fast reactions of this second act of the present has been based on that quote by Cedric Price that has more than 50 years. So imagine you, that's why I was telling in the first act that the present is nothing new. We are constantly living in the same present. But what happened after that? This is the longer part of the presentation. And it's the part that I think justifies the quote by Tacitadin that the future will be obsolete, because we have a very interesting field for action here, as we have been seeing today. And there are a lot of practices that go beyond these experimental and rapid projects that we have seen before, and try to understand the concept, the context, the problems we have, and try to react to them. So, in the past few years, we have seen a new energy on the people in different cities. This was one of the first massive protests in Europe after the crash in 2008 in Athens. This was in Spain. This is Occupy Wall Street. But I really liked this before, because it says that the revolution begins at home. And it's perfect that I'm lecturing after Tamar, and we have understood now that the home is not only the house. The home can be your social relationships, the interactions you do in public space. Your home can be your city. So this is very appropriate to be here in Romania, because you have been also, the people here have been also trying to take back the right to the city, since at least these pictures are from protests in Bucharest in the 1989, 1990, coming back in time with the mine protests. These are more recent in 2012, and the most recent from the past year. And I didn't include any picture because it was super recent, but we were talking before about the elections today. And it's very interesting how when people really understand that they can have a voice and do something, is the best way to start this revolution. Because having 70% of people voting in an election day, I think is really high in the context of Europe. We are not used to that. At least in Spain, our media, it's about 45 people voting or 50. So I think it's very interesting that to see that we are all like trying to understand the message and trying to react from our different fields of action. So I divide this part of the presentation in the four subtopics you sent to link with all the other lectures you have and other programs. And the first one is start. So how can we start knowing this context and this present? How we can to start working for doing something new? I think the most basic part or most basic understanding to start something new is to question ourselves. What is these things that we want to change from our current system in political terms, in economical terms, in social terms, and then try to develop the projects in a more relaxed way to try to go to the roots of the problem and to react to that. So there are a few projects that are based on this questioning. Maybe they are not solving a big problem, but they are using design and architecture to take this message to a wider audience. And I think this is really good for that. This project, Defense Distribute, is the project of a 3D printed gun that maybe you have seen in blogs or whatever, because it has become very famous in the past 2 years. And it was created by Cody Wilson, and he started researching on this over excess of 3D printed machines for almost everything, like the drones we saw before, and start developing this project that it's a gun, it's a weapon. And I think the important thing of this project is that he succeeded on designing a weapon that it works. You can shoot anybody with the gun. But the important thing behind this project is the reaction of the people and how people is thinking in new ways of understanding the problems we are living in. Because the project was created in America, in the US, and in the US you have the civil right to have a gun being a civil. You don't have to be a military or a policeman. But at the same time, when he created this gun, all the alarms were like, he was banned, the website was down, etc. So this reaction started making people to think, okay, if I have the right to buy a gun, but I cannot make it at home, it's because what they want is not that I don't have a gun, it's that I need to pay for that gun. So it takes the message that all this economical big infrastructure that we have behind the military's investments or even in some wars that instead of trying to stop the war, they keep the conflicts going on because they are selling and making a lot of money. So I think it's a very good project, at least to raise new questions for the people. This is a project that we are involved. It's the only one I think that the DPR is involved in all the projects that we will show. And it's based as well in this concern we have about questioning everything. With Malkit Shoshan from FAST and Marina Otero from Studio X, we start researching 1 year ago about all the military landscape and the use of drones and how they are changing as well our civic spaces now that they have become more common, and also you can buy nano drones or small devices. On this year that we have been researching, we were reading a report from the Human Rights Association on cities that lives under this pressure of drones, like Yemen, Pakistan, and how all these people that are living under that pressure, that they can be target of a drone attack at any time. It has emerged a new feeling, a new human need, that it's the retreat one, that they are going from the public space, hiding more, and they don't leave their houses, even they are looking for caves. In Pakistan, it was very super strong for me to read how some families are going back to living in caves, like thousands of years ago, used to be safe of the drones. So we developed this project that it's as well a lexicon, because we were trying to decide which was the best way to communicate all of this. And we decided that a lexicon and a collection of words was the best way to communicate that, because you can take at least 3 or 4 words of the whole lexicon and try to go in deep and understand these problems and how as a society we can react to that. This is the trailer.
Hello, Herr Holland. Ihr Haus ist fertig gezeichnet.
About that concerns by the use of drones, but then when you start thinking about and researching about the need to retreat, you go down as well to the new surveillance stuff, since Julian Assange and Edward Snowden has came out with all this information. We all know that we are here with our mobile phones here, and it's impossible to hide right now, even if you turn off your mobile. So how all these, the drones, these new technologies are creating this need, and how we can react or design new devices to really be comfortable and try to enjoy using our devices but feeling safe. So we create the lexicon, and as I was explaining to you before, and we decide as well, you can see some pages in black without any definition there. So people can also contribute as well and put their own thinkings. So I think we include some layers with augmented reality as well to also to confront people, because if we are criticizing the overuse of the digital devices because they are used to surveillance, but there is the fascination of using them to see videos, to use the augmented reality. So how can we deal with all our human contradictions? I think it's very important to start thinking on all these concerns. And that's why I was linking this project with the first tag of the start, because I think before taking any decisions, we need to question ourselves and to think. And this is the perfect start point. It's the same thing that this project, Conflict Kitchen, does in the US, in Pittsburgh, I think. They use, you know that there are a lot of countries worldwide that are in conflict with other ones, and mostly all of the time we don't know why they are in conflict. We just read in the mass media that one attacked the other and the other is making a blockage to the other, but we didn't get really in deep about these situations. So they create this project that they use food to communicate the people from the locality why the US is in conflict with different countries. So using food, what they do is to create a space where they can freely talk about the conflicts with more deeper information than the one you see on the television or the newspaper. And at the same time, they are creating a project in public space that make people discuss with others what they are. Because sometimes the problem with mass media, for example, or even in internet, it seems like we are in the internet able to discuss with everybody, but sometimes we are just reading and become what it's called like sofa activists, that we are retweeting all the protests, but we are doing nothing to. For that, so this kind of projects that provoke real interaction with the people has this value, and One thing that happened 2 weeks ago that I think is very important to notice is that the people from the conflict cities is feeling under pressure because they were on their trend 2 weeks ago because they set up the restaurant to discuss the conflict between Israel and Palestine, and there were a local community, a very small group from people from Israel that forced them to close the kitchen. So they closed for 2 weeks, put the case on the lawyers and went to the police, and then they were able to reopen just 1 week ago. And I think it's a detail that is very important, because if you are not hiding information, if you are not doing nothing bad, you don't care about that. But if you force them to close, it's because you feel sometimes on risk that the real details or real data are being put available for the people. So I think this kind of project that shares real information about the current times we are living and at the same time interact with the public space are a really good example to this part of the start tag of the whole present cycle. But the second one is education, of course, because we are talking here about the start, about discourse, about questioning, but education is a very important part of that, because at the schools, architecture schools, and in independent courses is the place when we get in deep on these problems. We can read or we can go to independent projects like the Conflict Kitchen, but in schools, we can share in deep and with a wider audience, with all our students, all these projects, all these problems at the same time, and try to design new solutions for this. And I think people is becoming aware of that, because in the past year, in the past 5 years, there have been a lot of new projects that are related with education, some of them in the architectural field, others not. But there is a new interest on the way we share knowledge as well, because there are a lot of issues that have been as well went under the same capitalist system, even in education. Some of the most renowned universities have become business companies more than universities, and the prices are higher, and the students need to make big loans to be able to study. So these new projects are, in a way, criticizing this way of envisioning what education is and trying to show that there are new ways of doing that. This project is very interesting. It's called the Asylum University, and it's a project for asylum seekers. It was born in London, because the UK has a long tradition of accepting people who is looking for asylum. But at the same time, their legal status is very diffuse. They have the legal right of being there, but at the same time, they don't have the right to work sometimes or to teach because they don't have the accreditation or to go to school. So they created this project for, especially for this group of people that lives under this condition, to demonstrate that there is no relationship between being an asylum seeker and the degree of knowledge you have. There are people there that they are PhD and have a lot of things that they can share with others, and they are not allowed to do so because they don't have the validation of their accreditations in this new country. So they create this project to do these open cycles and to demonstrate that they can find works and way of sharing all the knowledge they get in their countries before going to a new one. They have their own publishing company to share all these essays and these courses they do. So I think it's a very interesting way, because the target group is different. So education, it's becoming more dispersed and reaching more people. This is a very interesting project as well that is more related with architecture, because it's part of the architectural school in Mardin. Mardin is the city in Turkish that is nearby the Syrian frontier, the Syrian border. So what they are doing there, it's using architecture, but to work with the Syrian refugees because the school was founded 6 months ago. Now with all this conflict with ISIS that we all know, if you read the news or see the TV, that it's happening there. And this is the landscape that it's increasingly growing in this area every day. So they have an architecture school. They have a big problem there, so they create this program to work only on this, and not only theoretical basis. They do the workshops there with the people, they know their problems, and try to give solution to these people. So I think it's a very, yes, a very interesting way of envision how from traditional courses of architecture schools, we can have these like independent programs to really solve the problems that are emerging, because they are updating and emerging from 1 month to the other. And sometimes the programs we have in architecture school are from 20 years ago. So we need to react fast to the new problems we have and know how to attack the problem and to give solutions. So, well, this is the same, the landscape. And this, for example, is this was one of the first workshops they did that the students were very fast in 2 hours workshop proposing solutions. For that, now they have a more in-deep and longer workshops with other kind of projects more developed. But yes, it's interesting that with a very fast visit, at least the students have a notion that they can be, as well they can be useful, not only being designing on paper, but doing real things. And yes, it's a really wonderful project. And the pre-university in Milan, I have a lot of projects about education because, as I was telling you, there are a lot of them from the past 2 or 3 years. But I selected because maybe some of you were here from the Parasite workshop, and some of them are involved in this project, so you can recognize at least the philosophy of the way they understand what it's architecture, what it's education, and how they can use the knowledge they have from the practice to do new ways of new projects and new ways of developing. This guy, all the group were very tired of the university they were studying, very tired of the bureaucracy and the way that the programs were developing, and decided to create their own group. That it's called the IRAC-C Free University, and started working, inviting guest lecturers and people they know to give lessons every 6 months about the topics that at the same time they find that are the more crucial in the current times, the housing crisis, the public space. So they are doing two works at the same time. They are experimenting with new education ways, and at the same time, they are doing what I told you in the project before, trying to react to a current problem instead of being studying only the models of the past and the way we used to do things 20 years ago. So these are the kind of sessions they share, but they are also very active in Facebook, in the website. So if you are not able to personally attend, you can have information and learn more about these projects and to follow all the evolution of the lessons they are sharing. This is a more formal one in kind of masterclass. And we arrive to the street. Okay, the link between education and the street, I think is very well represented in this project. This is not a new one. By the way, it's very old, it's from 2009. In New York, there is this group, the Center for Urban Pedagogy, that is a group of graphic designers, but who work with lawyers and activists. And all their work, it's being done to help small groups or communities that are minorities. So this project, the Vendor Power, was born because they detected that the way of living of so many immigrants in New York is to become street vendors because they don't have legal right, again, to work there. So they do this kind of fast activities. They can have something to sell here, but move very fast if the police comes and move to another place. But this is not a way of living. There is no dignity behind this way of behaving. So they decided to study the laws from the use of public space in New York and discovered that there is a permission to use the public space by anybody, and even if it's for a commercial activity, and it just changes from one street to the other. For example, in the Fifth Avenue or Park Avenue, you need to leave more space in front of the shopping windows, of course, because the stores pay a lot of money for people to see. But there are other secondary streets that you can put a car or a hot dog a street car, and you can use it. I mean, it's not illegal, but the main problem is that the people doesn't know that they have the right. So they developed this manual, very IKEA style, because it's very easy to understand. And with these examples that you see here below, they show all the kind of spaces and structures or infrastructures they can use. And it's a way to share knowledge, it's to educate people, and at the same time to activate the public space in a way that nobody feels punished of using their street, because if you are living in a city, you have all the right in the world to use your street. So they are transmitting this this right to all these people that usually lives under fear and always hiding. This is another project that I really like it because you will see that it's very simple. So it's very important, I think, at this moment that we have seen all the past, present, I showed you before, to say it that way, that the economical system and, for example, universities that I was somehow criticizing before are used to work in big scales because it's the way they can manipulate a lot of people or change the mental framework of a lot of people. So if we want to react to that, I think we need to understand that we cannot use the same language they use. So if they are used to act in big scale, big companies or a big project in a public space as happened in Istanbul that the Occupy Gezi movement stopped, we need to subvert that way of thinking and start acting in a small scale to really try to catalyze the relationships, the use of public space, the way we develop our project. So this is Pablo Calderón, and he designed this project that it's a project to learn and to discuss problems at the same time. He is reinforcing an economic activity in the neighborhood, but economic, I don't mean exchange of currency. People doesn't pay euros to the other, they exchange services. For example, in this weekend, he was exchanging haircuts with people, and the people in exchange needs to talk about property. So they can share their concerns about public housing, about property, or possible solutions, because sometimes the people who come to make a haircut is not only the people who is having the problem. It can be a lawyer or someone who knows about the problem and how to solve it. So the idea is to make the exchange, it's like economical exchange if we understand economics in a broader way. Or this time that he was sharing films, and people use the public space, and at the same time they have the opportunity after the film is finished to discuss, to talk about the concerns. And this was very interesting because he put the clothes after, I don't know if you remember or if you have read in the news, when all these people, thousands of people died in Bangladesh in a clothing company. So they was interested in talking about that topic, about the cheap labor and the economical environment we are living. And it was very controversial because living in Central Europe, he was thinking that all the people that will come will be like the kind, same kind of thinking that he has. But he was explaining to me that a lot of people came and said, oh, well, if people die, at least they were working. And there are these kind of opinions that for me, it's like impossible to listen, at least with my group of friends. But of course, it's very interesting to also to open our mind that not everybody thinks like us. So it's very, very good to have these spaces for discussion, because it's very absurd to think that we can change the world only by the way we think. We need to learn from the others and to know which are the ways that others are thinking to try to really get into the roots of the problems. So I think this is the most important part of this project, that it's using the public space to try to talk and to react about these realities we are living on. And this is also another project about the street, very important, because the street is not only the small space, public space that we are using when we go to a square or a park. The street is all the infrastructure we have in our cities as well. And one of the problems we have in large scales is the waste management, for example, in our cities. And it's very funny, as I was just saying before, that we think that in a very superficial way that when we know something, the problems stop there. For example, if we buy this bottle of water, then we go to the container, we recycle it, and our conscience is, we can sleep super like a baby because we have recycled the bottle. But we don't know what happened after that because we don't research, it doesn't appear in the news. So this project from the MIT in Boston made a research about this. It's a video, so I will incredible when you realize all the energy, oil, everything that it's involved in the way we manage our waste. So I think it's very important to doesn't stop in the superficial part of the problems and try always to learn more, to go in deep, because the layers are so diffuse that sometimes we didn't reach that. But when you start researching or look for more projects, it can change not only the way we practice architecture, but our behavior, because at the end, everything is related nowadays, I think. So yes, everything is related, so we reach the profession. And even that all the other projects are related somehow, but the three projects we will see here, I think in my opinion, are very interesting because, as Anna told you in the presentation, apart from publishing, our work is more directed to research. And in the past years, after all these trends and reactions that we were seeing before, as a reaction to the crisis about how to use public space, pop-up, bottom-up, do-it-yourself projects, I think it was a very good couple or 3 years, because it's normal to have this fast reaction. You need to change something, so you react very fast, you try to do something, even if it's just a pop-up parking bay, that it's just one day, but you change the way your city looks or whatever. But I think now that we have more than 7 years having all these projects in mind, looking to them in several cities worldwide, because it's not only here in Europe, I think it's a very good moment to learn from all this energy and immediate desire of reaction, and try to understand that if we want to make big changes, or at least more structural changes long term, we have all this energy, all this knowledge, and now try to think in a new kind of projects that can really go in that way, in a more long term, to try to change really, not only for 1 weekend, but really the situation in different contexts. So one project that I really like is this one, Open Structures. We have it in Alhokrasi in Istanbul, that with Tamar we were working together there. And I think it's very interesting to how it represents what I was telling you, because it was born as an open source project with small pieces, small devices, but with the years, it has been growing up and really doing it not in a very impulsive way, really thinking how the project can grow up and can evolve. So instead of just having, for example, the files for 3D print some pieces or to fix some stuff in a very dispersed way, they have created a grid that it's helpful to assemble all the pieces that all designers from different countries in the world can upload. But if they respect small rules that are part of the first layer of the project, everybody can take advantage, because all the pieces can be assembled together, and it's on your mind and on your imagination how you can use that. So for example, they have created this is a set of toys, but you can see with the holes and the structure that it follows the grid. So they have from these boxes, you can see this one. And you can see also not only in the box that we saw before, but also in the pieces here. The distance between the holes is the same. So these kind of pieces can be assembled to do this toy, or can be assembled as well to do and become part of a kitchen that will become part of your home. So the way that a small project, if it is well structured and it's really collaborative, the way that it can grow up, it's really interesting, because it becomes really helpful in a larger scale, not only to have, for example, a toy that is very useful. I have 2 doubters and I would love to have these toys there, but as well, if I'm not able to go to IKEA and pay for a kitchen, I can do it myself, and it's even more helpful. So I think the richness of these kind of projects is that since the first moment that the designer or the architect start thinking about that, they are thinking in a long term and not only as an impulse. And I think it's the kind of project that can be very useful in the present we are living now. Or this project in Guatemala, I wanted to show this as well, because you can see that the context is super wide, from Timisoara to Guatemala. I don't know how many kilometers we have, maybe 40,000 or something like that. And Guatemala is a country that, as many countries in the world, has lived under an armed conflict, and it's living a post-war situation. And of course, these situations always bring as well inequality, a lack of services. And the biggest problem nowadays in Guatemala, it's the problem of housing. So the housing and inequality, these are the larger projects. So this group of researchers and architects are developing a project that it's a prototype, it's not yet being built, but they are working with a participative process with the communities, trying to solve the problem of social housing and at the same time the problem of inequality, trying to mix in up different social classes that I really don't know, as a foreigner, how is the context here, for example, but in Latin America, the difference between social classes and economical classes are super high. There is no medium. There is a lot of rich people and much more of poor people. So they are trying to fight this inequality and to build something that can make people living in a good condition together. So they are working with different groups and trying to develop different prototypes that it's very similar, but at the same time you can see that it's different, because also a problem with the war in Guatemala is that a lot of people from small villages came to the city to look for jobs, but they are used to another way of living. So instead of trying to force them to use the standard Western way of living, but at the same time not to keep in the poor conditions, just to trying to make a balance, a middle point, they are researching how to mix up the different prototypes and trying to develop the project. And it's very interesting because they have more than 3 years working, and it seems like fictional, because society usually follows to separate, but it's working really good. And they have this kind of, this is a meeting in Chiapas with the people from the SZLN, this guerrilla group in Chiapas, because the problem of the armed conflict is very similar in Guatemala than in Chiapas, but in this village in Mexico, they have succeeded in terms of housing for these people, so they went there to learn, and you can see there is armed people around, and it looks very dark, but the feeling and the learning and the way they went against their fears just to learn more, it was very, very strong, very. So I think it's very interesting how you can learn from places that you cannot imagine, but they are there, and you can have certain knowledge that can be related to our local context. And this is another project that was developed by Malki Shoshan, the Israeli architect, that we did the project of retreat together. And it's a very long project. She was working 10 years in this Palestinian village. That the big problem of this village is that it's Palestinian, but it's in Israeli territory and it's unrecognized. What does it mean that as being unrecognized, they don't have even a map or a number in their house, so they cannot give an address? So the implications of doesn't having an address are that you don't have electricity, water, you cannot have the most basic services. So she went there and started working to develop a master plan to give this village the status of a recognized village and develop a big plan. That's why the project was developed in 10 years. This is the master plan. And it's very interesting because the political situation there is very conflicting. So instead of forcing the political relationship, saying that they will develop a new master plan, whatever, she invented an artistic project to go there and invited a lot of curators, artists to do installations in the city, to allow the government to let these people in and then to use the time to develop some workshops to empower the local people, and instead of developing only themselves the master plan, to involve them and show them how they can do that, because they are also aware that it's very like paternalistic to go to a village, say, okay, I'm the architect, I will develop the master plan, and then to leave the city. And they have the same problems of every day, and they don't know how to face these problems. So the best way is to share this educational part with them. But as they were not allowed to do these pedagogical experiments, they undercover as an artistic project and develop projects for public space. It was Jonah Friedman there, Joseph Grimm, a lot of really interesting people that was sharing all this time with the local local inhabitants. And now the village has been recognized and they are using the master plan and the drawings and all the addresses to negotiate to the government to have all these services that they were missing, as electricity, water, etc. So I think this is a very successful project and a good example of what I was meaning about long-term projects that can really provoke a real change that is useful for the inhabitants of the place. This is an installation there as well, from this part of the artistic days, because they need to do something, if not they would be like discovered, and that's all. Thank you very much.